I'm Dr. Mubi from the Department of Parasitology, School of Public Health, and my topic is on vector-borne diseases and their control. So today's session, which is the first in the series, will cover the introduction, which is what are vectors and what are vector-borne diseases and transmission mechanisms. The outline of this presentation is going to be as follows. We are going to have a definition of a vector, and then a classification of important vectors of public health importance, and then transmission dynamics of diseases and the diseases of public health importance. So we are going to start with the definition of a vector. What is a vector? A vector is basically a carrier. It's like a vehicle. In medical sciences, we define a vector as something which carries the infection from one source to another. It can be from animals to humans or from humans to animals. And usually vectors are defined as living organisms that can transmit infectious diseases from humans or from animals to other humans. And sometimes they are defined as any non-human carrier of pathogens which transmit the organisms directly to humans. So basically that is what a vector is. It's just a carrier of pathogens from one host to the next one. And what are the vector-borne diseases? These are diseases whose transmission is facilitated by a vector. Without a vector, there'll be no transmission of these diseases. So vectors are the main mode of transmission which facilitate this transmission or transfer of pathogens from one host to another. And as such, they are an important part in the life cycle of these diseases. Many of the vectors that are involved in transmission of diseases are blood-sucking arthropods. And they ingest the pathogens or the disease-causing microorganisms during a blood meal from an infected host. And then later on, they inject to the next host. So when an arthropod sucks blood, it picks blood plus the pathogens, the disease-causing organisms, and then later on it injects to the next person when it goes for a second blood meal. Others, such as snails, they harbor the parasite's developmental stages and are usually referred to as intermediate hosts, but they are also vectors because they carry or they maintain the host, the parasite, during part of its life cycle. But as I said, arthropods are the most important vectors of diseases. And they have several importances as the vectors because they transfer pathogens from one host to another, and these pathogens can be bacteria, viruses, protozoa, or helminths. They can also affect us as ectoparasites by living on our skin, such as fleas, lice, mites, or they can produce venom and cause effect on the host, for example, bees, spiders, scorpions, and some of them cause allergic reactions. So arthropods are of great medical importance because of the different effects they have on human beings. So in classifying vectors, we have seen that we have mainly arthropods and then the snails, which belong to another group. So in the scientific classification, of course, the arthropods, we have two groups, Insecta and Arachnida. And basically, we don't have to go through the details, the scientific details, because I know some of your background are not medical. But the common names of these vectors include mosquitoes, tsetse flies, black flies, house flies, lice, cockroaches, ticks, and snails, which I am sure everybody have heard about those names. So, and these are, the species include the Anopheles, mosquitoes, or Aedes, which transmit malaria and the yellow fever. You have the Glossina, which transmits trypanosoma. We have cockroaches, which are mechanical vectors, and they can transmit diarrheal diseases, and so on. So in the transmission of these diseases, we basically have two types of infections. We have what we call anthropognotic infections, which are infections of humans, transmitted between humans and humans. So the vector acts to transfer the pathogens from the one human being to the next human being. And examples of this disease include malaria, dengue, and yellow fever, which are purely human diseases. But we also have other diseases which are, we call zoonotic. These are diseases of animals that can be transmitted to humans. And in this case, the human beings are kind of accidental hosts, because normally the diseases are transmitted between one animal and another. And examples include Lyme disease, hantaviruses, and many other arboviral diseases. So as I said, you have anthropognotic infections, which are human vector, human transmissions, and the human beings are the only reservoir. And you have zoonotic infections, which are diseases of animals, transmitted between animal and animal, but also man sometimes getting into the life cycle. And these diseases are, there is an animal reservoir. That is the main source of infection is the animal. And humans are considered a secondary or spillover or accidental host. So the type of transmission of the disease has implications for control. Because, for example, for the human infections, anthropognotic infections, these ones can be eradicated if you can treat all cases of disease in humans. While with zoonotic diseases, it's difficult to control because there is an animal reservoir. Unless you get all the animals to be treated or eliminated. Apart from the anthropognotic and the zoonotic, we also have different mechanisms of transmission. Biological transmission, in which the parasite requires a period of development in the vector in order to complete its life cycle. And usually this development involves multiplication, growth, or change in form to become infective to the next host. So the next, in this case, the vector is a necessary part of the life cycle of the parasite. And the vectors can either be referred to as intermediate hosts or definitive hosts, depending on the stage of the parasite, of the pathogen that they harbor. But you also have mechanical transmission, where the arthropod acts just like a vehicle, carrying the pathogen from one place to another, or from the environment to another host. And usually there is no development or multiplication. And the examples here of vectors are the flies, house flies, and cockroaches, which can carry pathogens from feces or from other filthy material to food sources. Of course, some of the diseases of public health importance are malaria, African trypanosomiasis, American trypanosomiasis, leishmania, lymphatic filariasis, schistosomiasis, and many arboviruses such as dengue, yellow fever, and so on. Vector-borne diseases are usually characterized by high transmissibility, and they have a very large range of transmission because the vectors are mobile. A mosquito can fly from here to several kilometers away carrying disease pathogens. So the range of transmission is large when you compare to those diseases which require direct transmission. And usually they are difficult to prevent or control because of the small size of the vector and the large numbers of vectors, and also the complex life cycle of both the parasite and the vector. And in those diseases which you said they are zoonotic, there is also the presence of non-human reservoirs of disease. So, and most of the time, the spread of disease is unpredictable, sometimes becoming epidemic due to factors such as increase in the breeding of the vectors and so on. Distribution of these diseases is usually determined by a complex dynamic of environmental and social factors. environmental factors may favor the breeding of the vectors, and social factors may also increase maybe contact with the vectors. And these diseases are usually more prevalent in tropical and subtropical countries, including sub-Saharan Africa, where you have climate which favors the breeding of vectors, poor environmental conditions, which may also facilitate the availability of breeding sites, and poverty, which may expose people to diseases. Changes in climate can also affect the transmission and the geographical range of these infections, because, for example, if there is warming or increase in temperature, then vectors which were initially not able to live in cold areas may be able to survive in those areas. Human activities can also affect the distribution, especially, for example, in areas which are on the border between animal and human habitats, like national parks or so, where people go into these areas for various activities. The public health importance of vector-borne diseases has been described as actually very big. Globally, about half of the world population are at risk of vector-borne diseases, which means they live in areas where they can contact the disease. And these diseases account for about 1 billion cases and over 1.5 million deaths every year. And overall, 17% of all infectious diseases are vector-borne. So you can see how big the problem is. So to summarize, this session just covered the introduction of what a vector is, which we said is a non-human carrier of disease. It can be an arthropod or a snail or any other non-human. There are also different mechanisms of transmission, which include mechanical and biological. And the public health importance of vectors is related to the disease they transmit. So, for example, diseases like malaria, the importance of mosquitoes are very important because they transmit malaria, dengue, filariasis, and so on. And also that the control of these infections depends on modes of transmission. If it is mechanical, if it is biological, or if it is zoonotic or anthropognotic, those modes of transmission will determine how these infections can be controlled. Thank you very much. This is the end of the session for today.